Welcome to the Advent Calendar House, the podcast that has once again emerged from hibernation after declaring four more months of winter to pretend it's still winter. It's Christmas in July, maybe, or possibly Groundhog Day in July? I'm not quite sure. And I don't think today's special is either, but we are once again returning to the enchanted world of Rankin Bass. So rise and shine and don't forget your booties, cause it's cold out there today, thanks to Jack Frost.
He's nipping at your nose. You can feel him in your toes. A shiver and a tear lets you know Jack Frost is here.
I am fashionable rodent with the world's most complicated snooze button, Mike Westfall. And joining me is a ventriloquist dummy I built to agree with everything I say when I get lonely. It's Jerry Davila from Totally Rad Christmas. Hello, Jerry.
Oh, Mike, it's good to be back here.
Well done.
Oh, so excellent and wonderful. And my accent is terrible. I'm going to stop. That's bad. I'm sorry. Yeah,
nip it in the butt now.
Yeah.
Also here is my knight in golden armor, even though gold is a terrible metal to make into armor, but it's okay because simply wearing it counts as a workout. It's Matt Spaulding from North Pole Radio. Hey, Matt.
Hey, Jerry. Jerry.
Well, Jerry's here.
Hey, how's it going? I'm here too, yeah.
Oh, hey, Mike. Good gravy. I'm off to a good start.
We all are. And the very embodiment of winter himself, with a sick habit of pulling the gravity out of under anyone. See, we're all. And the very embodiment of winter himself, with a sick habit of pulling the gravity out from under anyone who doesn't want to live in his neighborhood anymore. Please welcome Jeff Lofton from the Lost Christmas Podcast. Hi, Jeff.
Hey, everybody. Hey, thanks for having me, Mike. I actually forgot I was a podcaster and had to get my stuff out again.
Oh, damn well. We're all prepared.
Yeah. I'm loving it.
We're off to a great start.
We sure are. Thanks for being here, y'all.
No problem.
Yeah.
I'm not sure how well-liked or even well-known this special is. I did not grow up with this, but I think I knew it existed. I just didn't catch it until I was in my 20s. But first, let's hear about your own histories with Jack Frost, and we will start with you, Jeff.
So I love Rankin Bass. I didn't know this existed until I bought a collection of Rankin Bass DVDs, and it was on there, and I was like, what is this? Oh, it's reused stuff. And because that's what it is. Yeah. I love it, though. It's short, to the point, like a lot of Rankin Bass stuff. The story is nothing special, but I like it. It's just something different. So I'm definitely a big fan, which I might be alone in that.
I don't hate it. But we'll get talking about that. Matt, how about you? What's your history with this?
You know, I can't necessarily say I grew up with it, but it is one of those ones that like ABC Family, Freeform, whatever the heck they call it now, they'll stick it on the 25 days of Christmas, like maybe once. So like back when I had cable, I remember catching it every once in a while, you know, but you know, like Jeff, I didn't really remember. I hadn't seen it in a long time until I bought the Rankin Bass box set. And now, I won't watch it every year, but I'll throw it on once every couple of years, you know, just to catch up with it. It's not bad. Like, it's not like I hate it or anything. It's just not all, it's also not super special, but I guess we'll talk about that.
Yeah. Jerry, what's your history with Jack Frost?
So I didn't grow up with it, but I did see it a couple of times in the 90s. And then just like everything else, once I hit high school and college, I kind of pretty much forgot about it. You know, I was just thinking about girls and music.
Yep.
So completely forgot about it. And then just like you, Jeff, I bought a big old box set of Rankin Bass stuff. And there it was. And I was like, I remember this. Like, it's hard to forget the steampunkiness of it all.
Yeah.
So I'm with you. I also really like this one. It's weird, but something about it, there's a definite charm to it.
Just
unmistakable. But yeah, it's, I mean, Kubler Kraus is probably one of my favorite Rankin Bass villains.
Oh, dog.
For sure.
Because there's something a little bit unhinged about him, right? He's like talking to a ventriloquist dummy, and it's like himself that he's controlling. So it's very Batman villain-esque.
Yes,
it's the ventriloquist.
Yes.
Yeah. But I do remember when I did rewatch this again, and it was like early 2000s, I think, when I bought that box set. When I did watch it again, I remember trying to build a big timeline of Rankin Bass. And it was pretty easy to, sometimes they're a little hard because it is kind of more of a multiverse than just one big timeline.
Oh, yeah.
But this one was kind of easy compared to some of the others to actually put in like a specific time or, you know, at least order it and arrange it well. So, I kind of like it because of that.
you can. And then you have to pinpoint, all right, when does Jack Frost make his heel turn in Frosty's Winter Wonderland? That's where it gets complicated.
Right.
And at what point does he become a serial killing snowman?
That's definitely a different universe.
Okay. I'm sorry. Sure, I was confused. Is.
Yeah, that's not Rankin Prime, right?
Okay, never mind. Right. At what point does he become Michael Keaton, who gets killed by
Yeah.
To reconnect with his son.
Right. I think that's at the end.
That's definitely in the 90s. Right. Yeah.
Is that before or after Michael Keaton is in the Spider-Man movie? I can't get the timelines right because he's a villain.
During.
And he's, yeah.
That's right.
While they're all in Washington, he's just like, oh, I'm frozen. I'm back. I don't know. But so I didn't watch this until it started showing up on cable. But it wasn't until the 2000s for me. I believe AMC's the channel that has the TV rights now.
I think it has. Yeah.
Yeah. So it still gets airtime every December, but I don't have any personal nostalgia with it. This year, we put it on New Year's Eve.
Okay.
Oh, nice.
It was just, let's see. What's left in there? Because we don't watch any of the ball drop or anything for New Year's Eve. We just...
No.
It's not a thing my family was ever into. We had just finished watching Rudolph's Shiny New Year, and there was still time left until midnight.
Yeah.
Because this isn't 100% a Christmas special, even. Like, it's got Christmas in it, but it's also Groundhog Day.
It's more Groundhog Day than Christmas to me.
Underutilized, not holiday. Yeah.
So I usually watch it around February 1st, February 2nd. Yeah.
I feel like they have to, like, remind us it's Christmas as we go through the special.
They totally do. Yeah.
Yeah.
And then it goes on past that, but...
It's very much the Leprechaun's Christmas Gold of Groundhog Day, you know?
Sure. Yeah.
You know, where it's like they had this story and then, well, we can sell Christmas better. So let's just cram Christmas in there.
Right.
Let's put a tree.
Yeah. Like that's not a St. Patrick's Day special. St. Patrick is in it kind of
ish. Yeah.
But that's just, you know, I'm still convinced they had the rights to the song Christmas in Killarney and they just wrote a special around that.
Mm-hmm. So actually, that was a late addition to it.
Really?
So it was going to be a St. Patrick's Day special. I was talking to Rick Goldschmidt about this right before I covered it.
Yeah, you're buddies with Rick Goldschmidt.
And he was telling me it was actually going to be that. And then ABC, it was Michael Eisner.
Hello.
Who literally was like, no, we can't sell a St. Patrick's Day special. You got to do it for Christmas. So then they crammed Christmas in it, which is why it feels like it. And then they just threw in that Christmas in Killarney last minute.
Oh, Michael Eisner.
Yeah. But I kind of feel like this is exactly what they did with this one. You know, it's really because it's told by Pardon Me, Pete. I mean, there's just a lot more Groundhog than Christmas, I feel.
Yeah,
it's 100% a transitional season special. Yeah.
Well, it's the origin of the tradition of the groundhog seeing his shadow.
Sure. Yeah.
Right.
And I think that... this was the last Rankin Bass special my kids had not watched yet, and I don't think my wife had either.
Oh, wow.
But the general consensus while watching was, this story is weird.
that checks out.
And also, The Little Mermaid did all of this better.
Not wrong.
Well, which Little Mermaid?
All of them.
I don't know, man. If you go in, like the what is it, the original Grimm is pretty dark.
Well, that's true. Yeah,
we had, so right after The Little Mermaid came out in 1989, we had found a VHS, you know, how like other animation companies will put out other versions of it, like a cheapo version.
Straight to video.
This was an old 70s anime version.
Oh, wow.
That's awesome.
That is closer to that original Hans Christian Andersen story.
Love it.
That has the bad ending to it, but like,
wow,
we were just, I kind of have like a love of that just because, I don't know, I like that I grew up watching The Snowman every Christmas, so I'm used to those sad endings.
Yeah, so. Right.
But this definitely is like, do you remember that movie with Meg Ryan and Nick Cage? It was like City of Angels, where he was like an angel and he falls in love with her. That's it's like that. It's like the bishop's wife. I mean, it really is like that. But you're right, those movies just do it a lot better than than this one here.
Sure. Yum. But let's get into this one. Jack Frost first aired December 13th, 1979. It was a Thursday night on NBC, a little over 2 weeks after the TV premiere of Rudolph and Frosty's Christmas in July, which I think that movie was when Rankin Bass's holiday output kind of jumped the shark.
It's funny because I really do love Rankin Bass.
Oh,
and
yeah.
That's like the Avengers, you know.
It's like,
everybody gets together and you're excited, but it's makes no sense. They should have just set it completely at Christmas time. They didn't need to bring July into it. But we do get like a first glimpse of Jack Frost.
Yeah.
In that one, you know, in the traditional animagic.
Is it the same model? I think it's the same model.
No, it's not the same model. There's actually slight differences, you can tell.
Okay.
But it is close.
Yeah.
That's where we get him like blowing on Frosty.
Riding
in the sleigh.
Right, and he's still got the Paul Frees voice from Winter Wonderland too, so.
Yep.
I love it.
But yeah, that I think was the beginning of the end as far as their Christmas canon was concerned. You had that, then this. Then only three more after this, not counting that Santa Baby that came out of nowhere in 2001 before they shut down for good. But
right.
But if you want to watch Jack Frost as of this recording, it is free on YouTube.
Oh, yes.
If not, it is streaming on Amazon Prime Video if you subscribe to that, or it's on Tubi if you want to watch it there. But we open with Rankin Bass's favorite opening gag, a newsreel about the world's most revered groundhog, which I take issue to, but yeah, pardon me, Pete.
Time, Groundhog of the Year, Pardon Me, Pete. Reader's Digest, Pardon Me, Pete, the most unforgettable groundhog I ever met.
I'll give him a pass here as the world's most revered groundhog because I don't think anyone outside Pennsylvania knew about Punxsutawney Phil before 1993. So, fine.
That's
fair.
Yeah.
Fair.
Yeah, I first learned about him from Groundhog's Day.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Same.
Yeah.
You have a bunch of other groundhogs from around the country you learn about in news articles every year. Like, look, these groundhogs also exist, but...
But no one cares.
No one cares about that.
I mean,
what if it was just his, like, it's just the same groundhog and that's just like his stage names for like the different areas?
Yeah, he's got a whole underground network that he's got to run around different time zones.
I will say though, like, you could kind of believe that from the groundhog's house in
that's,
this.
Yeah,
that's true.
You know,
yeah,
it's true.
Pretty huge. Yeah. It's like Fraggle Rock.
It is like Fraggle Rock.
He just has his whole network underneath.
Yeah, he's got like a posh living area, and that's just his bedroom that we see. So Pardon Me, Pete is voiced, speaking of The Little Mermaid, by Buddy Hackett.
Me and my shadow strolling down the avenue.
Yes.
Known to me because he was Scuttle from The Little Mermaid, but...
That's right.
Do you know Buddy Hackett from anything else?
I remembered him from Scrooged, actually.
From Scrooged, yeah.
Because he plays Scrooge in the adaptation.
Right.
A goose.
That's right.
My favorite frame of reference for Buddy Hackett is so stupid and obscure.
Oh.
Gilbert, he was in a biopic of Abbott and Costello.
Huh.
Oh.
And he played Lou Costello.
Costello.
Right.
Oh, wow.
And Gilbert Gottfried. This is why it's so stupid. Gilbert Gottfried was obsessed with this documentary because he said he would always do this thing where he would talk about how Buddy Hackett's Lou Costello death scene was one of the wildest things he'd ever seen on cinema.
They have a death scene?
No, I gotta catch this.
He would do an impression of it because on his deathbed, all he wanted was a strawberry malted milkshake. And apparently, I've never seen this movie, by the way. I've only heard Gilbert's impression of it from back when he would do his podcast when he was still alive. But that was the best strawberry malted I ever had. And just die.
I gotta watch this now.
I have to see this movie, but in my mind, I just want it to live as Gilbert's impersonation of it. Real. So I almost don't.
Yeah, no, I can't watch this after I just heard that impression of an impression of an impression.
I know, it's so stupid.
Wow.
But it popped into my head while I was watching this movie. I was like, oh yeah, Gilbert was obsessed with Buddy Hackett's death scene as Lou Costello.
My two Buddy Hackett touch points are The Little Mermaid and The Music Man.
Mm.
And I guess The Love Bug. He was in the first Love Bug movie.
Oh, he was.
Oh,
yeah.
Yes, he was. That's right. I haven't seen that movie in a minute.
And then I just remember Adam Sandler has a throwaway line in The Wedding Singer where he says something like, I'm probably going to grow up to look like Buddy Hackett. Which it's not that far.
great impresario to get for, you know, a great performer to get. When you need somebody to sing a song.
Yes. So yeah, this Christmas special starts on Groundhog Day. Fine. Again, this is the same year as Rudolph and Frosty's Christmas in July, which takes place on the 4th. So this is the phase we're in at this point.
Mm-hmm.
We've got a TV news reporter waiting outside. Pardon me, Pete's little hobbit house as he opens the door, sees his shadow.
Oops. Pardon me.
But how could Pete have cast a shadow? It's impossible. There's no sun today.
Pardon me.
Yeah. So the reporter looks very distinct because he is voiced by actual newscaster David Garraway.
Nice.
He was the first anchor of the Today Show.
Hmm, that's cool.
That's a nice little tidbit.
That's a good pull.
Yeah.
Good guy.
Yeah.
But we join Pete down in his den as he tells us his shadow is magic. It's like Peter Pan's shadow, I thought. It's got a life of its own. We see him dancing with it.
If you're going to dance with, you know, when nobody's watching, might as well dance with your shadow.
Sure. Yeah. Well, here was my thought process. Does every famous Pete have a magic shadow?
Ooh. I want to see Pete Rose dancing with the shadow.
Oh, my gosh.
Pete Davidson's magic shadow.
Oh, dear. Spider-Man's a famous Pete. Is his magic shadow Venom?
Oh, man.
I'm into it.
Or is, pardon me, Pete's magic shadow an alien symbiote? It kind of looks like one later.
Now I want, like, Buddy Hackett, pardon me, Pete, like, for real, in the Venom symbiote. Just,
sure, yeah, oh, they yeah. should have put Attacking. Him in Christmas in July.
But, right?
That would have been cool.
Oh, man. Yeah. You guys are blowing my mind right now.
My work here is done.
One thing I do remember is that in the L. Frank Baum novella, The Life and Adventures of Santa Claus,
yes.
it might have been one of the other ones, but Santa Claus actually does run into Jack Frost.
Mm, that is Life and Adventures of Santa Claus.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And Jack Frost, he has the power to like freeze people's shadows and make them kind of come to life and control them. So,
oh,
I wonder if they pulled that from there.
They might have.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Wow. Thank you for reminding me of that. I totally didn't think of that. No, here he explains his magic shadow belongs to Jack Frost somehow. He says he and Jack have a deal where Pete will see his shadow and pretend to be scared so we get 6 more weeks of winter because the weather is booked like wrestling.
Yep,
that's right.
That's how it works.
Yeah,
hey, well, brother. I got 6 more weeks of winter, brother.
I will say, Pardon Me, Pete is kind of dressed like some manager from the 70s with the straw hat and the waistcoat.
That's fair.
That is true.
Listen, I've dined with kings and queens and I've slept in alleys eating fucking beans.
Waiting on a hot chime.
I gotta come here and I gotta see my shadow, don't you understand? The American dream. Pardon me, Pete.
Listen, Ric Flair.
Oh, goodness.
Well, here, instead of the old Rankin Bass standby, you've never heard of Jack Frost? Yes, we have. Instead, Pete says, unlike his own shadow, nobody has ever seen Jack Frost unless you count this one time. And here we go.
Well, we also get somewhere in here, they have just that little one line of the Christmas song.
Right.
Jack Frost nipping at your nose.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is why we're here, folks.
Mm-hmm.
Just to acknowledge, you know, it's Jack Frost who's nipping at your nose. It's that guy. Same guy. But then we get a whole different opening song here, which is a lot more jaunty. I kind of like it.
Mm-hmm.
I got to say, overall, I think Maury Laws has written a lot of great music for Rankin Bass. But the ones in these were not my favorite. I think the one I like best is There's the Rub.
Yeah.
Like that one is really memorable. But some of the others, it's like if you asked me to sing them now, I couldn't. So,
yeah. Oh, we'll get to one of them.
We will. Yeah. This opening song, though, has been in my head for months planning this episode.
Oh, nice.
It's just da-da-da. He's nipping at your nose. But to set up Jack's story, he introduces us to a faraway town called January Junction, just to confuse everyone.
Right. Again, which makes me think mm-hmm. this really was like closer to not a Groundhog special.
Yeah.
Let's just do the whole calendar. We're being told a story in February that begins in November, set in a town named after January. Eventually, I'm going to forget it's a Christmas special.
Except for that later on, you get exactly what you always wanted.
That's right. But let's not get ahead of ourselves. Pete says the tale of Jack Frost begins one late autumn day, about a month before Christmas, as a group of pumpkin peasants were harvesting their crop. Pumpkin farmers. He calls them pumpkin peasants. I'm thinking, are they going to have like pumpkin heads? No, they're just farmers.
Mm-hmm.
It's an old married couple living on a pumpkin farm. We have Mama, who is voiced by Dee Stratton.
A copper kaputnik? Papa, how?
I hid it from Kubla Kraus so I'd have something to buy Christmas presents.
You shouldn't take the chance. What good is one kaputnik? It takes 100 of them to make a penny.
I don't think I've mentioned her before. She did have a small role in another Rankin Bass special I've covered, The Stingiest Man in Town. She was Scrooge's nephew Fred's wife in that for like a line.
Oh, wow.
Oh.
So maybe that's why I didn't mention her. She just like had the one line at the end. But Stingiest Man in Town is going to come up a few more times. That's from the year before this, and they brought a lot of the voice cast from that back for this.
Right on.
Yeah.
But Papa Pumpkin Farmer is voiced by Larry Storch, who is probably best known from the show F Troop.
Mm-hmm.
I never watched F Troop. I just remember Nickelodeon airing reruns of it. But even as a kid, I thought, nah, I'm good.
That's when you change the channel. You're like, black and white.
Yeah. When that came on Nick at Night, it was like, no, thanks.
Yeah. Yeah, I never watched it either, actually.
There were some things on Nick at Night I liked. Like, we watched Happy Days. Like, my brother and I loved Happy Days.
Yeah.
I think the Monkees were on. Well, the Monkees kind of was that transitional time.
Monkees was also on MTV a lot.
Yeah, it was. But Larry Storch was also an original Ghostbuster. Do you know?
Oh, from the film.
From the 70s, the live 70s action one. Show from the 70s, right. Called The Ghostbusters with the gorilla.
Right.
Yeah.
And that is, I think that's supposed to be the dads, right? Of the
cartoon characters.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Nice.
Larry Storch was also the first animated voice of the Joker in early Batman cartoons.
Wow.
That's right. He was. He had to. Shoot, no, I can't do that. It's a different voice. I can't do it. Like, it's so different. I can't even personate it.
Yeah, it's like very high pitched.
Mm-hmm. Ah, Batman.
Kind of. Also in the late 60s, he voiced a few of those newer Looney Tunes characters that never quite caught on, like Cool Cat and Merlin Magic Mouse. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, I do. Yeah. Pass.
Yeah.
They were my favorite.
I will mention one more Larry Storch credit because I don't know if I'm ever going to have a chance to talk about him again, but he voiced the McDonaldland character Captain Crook, the pirate.
Oh, that's cool.
Who liked filet of fish.
That's super cool.
That's quite an obscure resume.
It's very eclectic for sure.
Yeah. This eclectic fabric of characters across many universes.
Remember this guy? How about this character? Oh, also the Joker, but
not Mark Hamill.
But not Mark right, Hamill. Right. No,
not
no.
the good one. Mark Hamill. Yeah. No. If it's a Joker you remember, it's not him.
Yeah. No. Here he is, Papa the Pumpkin Farmer, who is too poor to even afford a horse. Mm. They have a dog, they have a duck, no horse, because they live in a kingdom ruled with a literally iron fist by Kubla Kraus.
Yeah.
Okay, but hold on just a second.
Oh.
The dog and the duck are adorable.
They are. Yeah.
Touche.
Granted. Yeah.
I thought it was just going to be like a passing. We have a dog and a duck, but we can't afford a horse. The duck comes up later.
Mm-hmm.
But
as does owning a horse.
Yeah. Yup.
For some reason.
For some reason.
Yeah. Yeah. We'll get into it.
Yeah. But Kubla Kraus, and who else to voice a bad guy with a gruff Eastern European accent than Boris Badenoff himself, Paul Frees?
On Kling Stamper, I smell like a putnik.
Oh, man.
I was going to say, but the Burgermeister Meisterburger.
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah, it's all the same.
Or Santa, you know.
Same. Yeah.
Well, yeah, but his Santa has never had that Eastern European accent like those others.
No.
Yeah, but I was gonna say, what did they say about I smell a kaputnik?
A kaputnik is money. It's worth 1/100th of a penny. You know, like coupons.
Yeah. Oh Lord.
The coupon.
Yeah.
not redeemed for.
Are we going to mention that they call him a Cossack?
He's the Cossack King, but there are no Cossacks. They all left because they didn't like him. He's going to sing a whole song about it later, but for now.
I just found it so odd that they specified this for, like, I guess just for that one song. Mm-hmm. They wrote the song and then added that to his character. Okay, anyway, carry on.
And it's just like, what are they called? Yeah, not the SARS. We'll throw that in the song too, but I don't know. It's a word they knew.
Well, they wanted to give him the big, tall, fuzzy hat.
That's it. Yep.
That's probably, yeah.
That's exactly it.
I believe that's a Cossack-type hat.
Ash's Army of Darkness hand, you know?
Yeah. Well, again, literally an iron fist. He also rides an iron horse across the countryside looking to squeeze every last copper kaputnik out of his poor subjects. So he grabs Papa.
We used to accept kaputniks at my store, but we don't anymore.
So. Ah.
Can we talk about his horse? Because Jerry mentioned earlier the idea of very steampunk. However, this is very medieval Eastern Europe, and steampunk wasn't till, or supposedly the idea of steampunk is it's set in what, the Victorian time?
Right. Yeah. Right?
Yep.
And like he's riding a steam powered mechanical robot horse and has wind up like, TikTok from Return to Oz.
Yes,
yes, yes, 1,000,000%.
Uh-huh.
It's like, what era is this supposed to take place in?
He was just ahead of his time, man. He was a visionary.
No, he invented steampunk, but it wasn't the Victorian era yet. So everything just kind of looks like a Franklin stove.
Okay. Because isn't Sir Ravenel like, doesn't he go to be a knight like with King Arthur?
With King Arthur, yeah. So that's super early.
So it's way early. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that's that's like Dark Ages.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Right.
Okay.
I'm thinking that this castle was home to like a genie or something.
Could have been.
Oh, I like that.
And the genie abandoned the castle and And Kubla Kraus wound up with all this stuff. He didn't really know how it worked, but he just over time just kind of figured it out.
It's like, well, guess I live here now.
This is called stumbling into success.
Yeah.
What is it? What do they say? You're promoted right to the level above your competence.
That's right.
Failing upward.
That's right.
But yes, just shakes the last Kaputnik out of Papa's pocket. He was saving that to buy a Christmas present, but Mama tells him not to worry because soon it will be winter, and when Jack Frost comes, they'll have ice money. And sure enough, we see semi-transparent Jack Frost fly over the pumpkin patch, bringing the gift of winter to the good farmers.
Mm-hmm.
Is Jack Frost the Great Pumpkin? Did Linus just get confused?
Maybe. I did like a lot of the effects on this, like some of the production value. You can tell they're later on in their years because they're definitely better with the stop motion and with some of their effects than they were earlier on.
I agree.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, even this transparency is done better than it has in the past.
Yeah.
So, ice money. Pardon me, Pete explains, this kingdom is so poor. In the winter, they sliced up icicles into, or as he calls them, frozen assets.
They'll be here all week, folks.
Yep.
Tip your waitress.
Anyway, as Jack Frost is flying around town making it winter, he nips at the nose of Papa and Mama's daughter, Elisa.
I'm going out into the countryside. It's so beautiful with snow, like a Christmas wonderland.
Who's voiced by Deborah Klinger. I have mentioned her in the Stingiest Man in Town episode as well. She voiced Martha Cratchit in that and sang that song, Yes, There is a Santa Claus.
Okay.
So Elisa just adores winter. She says she wants to go to the countryside and see Jack Frost's work before anyone spoils it. Her parents were hoping she was running off to meet a boy, but she hasn't met anyone yet. Papa asks, aren't you in love with anybody yet? And she jokes, only Jack Frost. And Jack hears this.
Oh, right. Boy. This jumpstarts the whole plot.
Yeah,
right,
he's suddenly very interested. So we see him watching Elisa skate on a frozen pond with a bunch of tiny animals. When Kubla Kraus comes racing across the pond on his heavy iron horse, causing the ice to crack. And all the little bunnies and squirrels or whatever that were skating with Elisa just hop onto dry land and leave her to fend for herself.
That's right.
That's amazing.
Well, lady, it's been fun, but you're on your own now.
Peace. Sorry.
And here's where I need to ask. Why do people insist on ice skating near waterfalls?
I don't know. I'm from South Texas, so ice skating's not even a thing.
Yeah, I'm from Texas also. Yeah.
Yeah. Not, yeah.
I wouldn't know unless it's at the Galleria. I can't really tell you about
yeah,
ice skating.
Yeah, and I've only done that once, and same. I fell a lot, so.
Waterfalls are scary. I've been near waterfalls, and rivers are moving. They
right.
don't freeze solid.
They don't freeze like that, but we see this trope happen way too often. Disney's done it at least twice.
See, I think they must because I've seen it on TV and I'm from Texas. So no, I don't know why. That's crazy. Yeah, that's crazy.
It's just a bad decision, but
different gravity rules, I guess, and
laws of physics,
universes. Yeah, they just function differently.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Well, it's cold.
That's right.
Got a lot of non-Euclidean geometry.
I love that.
I mean, that one clearly froze because Jack Frost did his little whistle.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, that's true. That's true. Yeah, he's got the magic.
Yeah, he freezes the entire waterfall.
Which, okay, I want to get into like the whole mythology of Jack Frost and his race and everything. And I know we'll get there, but I'm like, I was trying to make sense of this as a kid.
Yeah.
And so I was imagining, you know, all sorts of things, but I want to hear your guys' thoughts on it when we get there. And I'm sorry, I'm jumping ahead.
It's okay. It's all right.
It just, you reminded me of it. It's like, I have these questions.
Bring it up later. But
yeah.
Yeah. He freezes the entire waterfall and guides Elise a single chunk of ice gliding gently down to the bottom of it. She can't see Jack. He's invisible to everyone, but she just calls out to him, Jack Frost, you're a hero. And now he's smitten.
Be a hero.
Yeah. Now he wishes he was a human like Elisa. And he sings a sad little song about how lonely he is.
The happiness of being me is not what it's cracked up to be. It's lonely being one of a kind.
And it was Robert Morris, right?
Yeah, the voice of Jack Frost is Robert Morris. I've talked about him. He was the first Easter Rabbit.
Yeah, Stuffy.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
But y'all probably know him best now for Mad Men. He was Bert Cooper.
Never got into it.
Never watched me. Yeah.
Okay.
Nope. I know more from the first Easter Rabbit.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah,
I mean, sorry. He kind of looks like the first Easter Rabbit in real life.
He actually does. Yeah. Yeah.
For normal society, that might have worked, but not this crowd.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
We don't under, we're
a little bit niche. Yeah. Sorry. Yeah.
So Jack sings this song about how lonely his existence is. And this, more than any other part of the special, is what reminded me of another Jack Frost story. Did anyone else find themselves comparing this to Rise of the Guardians?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
No, but I did just see that movie for the film.
Love it. Love all the books.
It. Yeah. Have you read the books? The books are great.
Books are great.
Yeah.
Have not read the books yet.
Jerry and I've had this discussion many times.
Yeah, they're better.
Are they better?
The books
okay.
are great. Yeah, the books are really, really good.
My son really got into the movie and the whole idea of the Guardian. So I think I'm going to have to get those for him.
So fun fact, my hometown of Abilene, Texas, is the storybook capital of Texas. And they have statues of all the different characters from the story throughout downtown.
Oh, that's cool. That's amazing.
Yeah, and during... They have a storybook festival there every year, and you get to see like the characters there too.
Oh, wow.
Shout out to the Abilene Storybook Festival.
That's super cool.
They have a storytelling team at my kid's school, and they have a festival every year. And theirs is in Tampa, but I mean, to do something like that sounds like a really big deal. So I might have to look into that one summer.
It's really cool.
But we don't really get an origin story for Jack Frost in this special. But in Rise of the Guardians, he's a human who saves his sister from falling through thin ice, but ends up being saved from drowning himself by the man in the moon and becomes an eternal being no one else can see. And it makes him feel very lonely for hundreds of years.
Wait a second.
In this special, they just have Jack sing half a song about being lonely. He doesn't even get to finish the song.
He got things to do, man. There's no time to sing all of it.
Right. First, he flies up to his home in the sky, the kingdom of the winter clouds.
Yes.
Ruled by Father Winter.
Outright insubordination.
Also voiced by Paul Frees. That's a joke.
Of course.
I mean, who doesn't Paul Frees voice?
Right. You know? Yeah. No, but
it's fair.
Can we talk about Father Winter? Because his character design looks an awful lot like Winterbolt.
Yeah, well, okay, so this is where I want to get into this mythology here.
Do it.
This is like an entire kingdom of all sorts of winter people. There's like winter sprites. There's the Hail Fellow. There's all these guys. You know, and so like, okay, how does Winterbolt relate? How does the Winter Warlock or Zero as well, you know, relate.
Right?
So like, I want to get into it all. Like, I don't know, but I need to know.
Yeah.
I always used to say that like Winterbolt was Morgoth and like the Winter Warlock was like Sauron, you know, that was like how I put it together. But now there's like a whole kingdom. So
yeah,
maybe not.
Well, there can be lots of lieutenants. Right?
That's true.
I mean, sure.
That's true.
Yeah. I mean, and they get like, they get into those little characters that we see and never hear from again, like the Hail Fellow.
The Hail Fellow.
He doesn't even have any lines. They just show him just like, that's where hail comes from. It's a dude.
And the snowflake, what do they call it? Snow gypsies?
The snow gypsies. Yeah. That might be problematic nowadays.
Thankfully, right? It's just a stupid name.
Yeah.
But they look more like elves in grayscale.
That's true, they do.
Their skin and clothes have no color to them. They're cloud people. They all look like clones of Jangle Bells from the Year Without a Santa Claus.
You gotta stick with what works.
Not Jingle Bells, specifically Jangle Bells.
Jangle, yeah.
Except one. There's a smaller one. Her name is Holly. She is the keeper of Christmas snow.
Christmas snow.
And yeah. Holly is voiced by Dina Lynn. She's back.
Humans are never as graceful as sprites.
Dina Lynn.
Speaking of the first Easter Rabbit, she was Glinda in the first Easter Rabbit. Ooh, and now that is a very recognizable voice for me just because of her cadence, like reciting those lines.
Nice. Yes.
Yeah.
She was also in the Santa Claus is Coming to Town and the first Christmas, the story of the first Christmas snow.
Mm, gotcha. Those are all great.
Jack Frost is her most recent credit on IMDb. Her entire filmography consists of 1970s holiday specials.
Oh, okay.
I guess she grew up or something.
Yeah.
She was someone's neighbor.
Neighbor, yeah. Relative, that's something.
I'm guessing that's it. It's like, hey, you want to be on TV? All right, cool.
I need a little girl's voice.
Sure. There's nothing else on the internet about her. I don't know if she's still alive, but every time I hear Dina Lynn's voice in one of these specials, I recognize it instantly now, so... Just doing the DiCaprio point at the TV.
Nice. Well, okay, so Father Winter, he's in charge of this whole kingdom, right?
Yes.
But later on, he says he even takes his cues from Mother Nature. Mm-hmm. So the theory that Anthony and I came up with when we covered the special was that he is Snow Miser's father.
Oh.
Good point.
The theory I had going was that Yeah, he was like brothers or something with Winterbolt. And they got two old man Winter characters now in this universe. Winterbolt's lawful evil, whereas Father Winter's more like lawful neutral, I guess.
Yeah, I would say neutral.
I just make it cold. But
I wonder if it's like a past leader, current leader, and then there's somewhere down the road, there's like a future leader. You know, there's
I could dig that too. Yeah.
I was thinking Winterbolt was more like if I try to think of an evil wizard that's not, because I keep thinking Gandalf because of the long white beard, but not Gandalf.
Saruman?
Yeah, like if Saruman like had a kid with like Iceman from the X-Men.
Okay.
You know, not necessarily a force of nature, just an evil wizard with ice powers.
Sure. Oh, Bobby. We also have Snip the Snowflake Maker.
Yeah.
Is this Snip?
Of course this is Snip. Who else would be answering Snip's phone?
I need 10 million for Minneapolis.
10 million for Minneapolis? Oh.
Voiced by Don Messick.
Hampton J. Pig.
That's your Don Messick reference?
I know, right?
Absolutely.
Wow.
Not Bam Bam or Scooby-Doo or like...
He uses the exact Hampton J. Pig voice.
You know, he does. Yeah, that's a very good point. It is the Hampton voice here. But last time I talked about him on this podcast, he was Ranger Smith in Yogi's First Christmas.
And Yogi. Yeah. Boo Boo, right? He does Boo Boo as well.
Yeah. But no, he's absolutely. This is a Hampton voice. Yeah, I didn't even make that connection, but you're absolutely right.
I'm a Tiny Toon. Tiny Toons was my era, you know. So that's an indelible part of my conscious is the Hampton J. Pig voice.
All right, nice. But who else lives up here? A couple of older looking women called the Sleet Sisters,
mm-hmm.
who are dressed like laundry maids that wring what we know as sleet out of a wet towel.
But here's the thing, when I was watching all of this, it is very much like a child's idea of how weather works.
Sure.
Though, right?
Yeah.
Like you remember like when you were a kid, like thunder is just angels bowling.
Angels bowling,
like
that's what my grandmother said.
Yes.
Nice. So it's the same thing. It's like, oh yeah, sleet is just these two old ladies just up there bringing it out there.
They're doing the laundry.
You know? So it's just such a kid's idea of how weather works.
I do like that.
Yeah. Oh, the Rankin and Bass just called up their moms and was just like, what did you used to tell us about where sleet comes from?
Well, this was Romeo Muller, wasn't it?
Romeo Muller, yeah.
Sure. Right. Yeah. So that makes sense.
Yeah.
He has a lot of out there ideas.
Sure does.
But I have one more question since we're talking about they all have these roles, right?
Uh-huh.
Jack Frost's role is just Frost? Like, what is he? What is his...
He's application.
Right? Yeah, others, okay, sure.
I think others provide the power, and he's more of like a conduit for power.
Oh, there,
that's,
I like
that's
that.
My interpretation, right? So
very nice, Jeff.
He's like the power sword.
Yeah,
to He-Man.
That makes sense. Okay, because yeah. I'm sitting here trying to figure out like what is he?
He comes Ooh. First, so he's Silver Surfer.
Oh, there you go. He's the Herald. Yeah,
here
yeah,
comes like Winter. That. Winter's coming.
Winter's coming.
Okay, okay.
That's brilliant.
Oh man, would that make him the first White Walker? Is he a White?
Oh, maybe.
Could
yeah,
be.
I like that.
He's dressed the part.
We're spiraling. I apologize.
Yeah, it's
okay. Sorry, it's my fault. I started on all this.
You know what? If you don't spiral, it's not a podcast.
That's
true.
That's fair.
That's true. Yeah.
We'll return to our program after these messages.
Whee!
Today's the day!
Woohoo!
There's the second most famous groundhog in Pennsylvania.
Am I late?
Just in time. Nice.
Holiday scratch-offs from the Pennsylvania Lottery.
Oh, things just got very merry. Keep on scratching.
It's Groundhog Day!
Sonic 3 is coming.
Look for the shadow!
On Groundhog Day. Make that Hedgehog Day.
Did you see the shadow? Take
off! Sonic 3, February 2nd.
If you've ever wondered about the history of Santa Claus, the traditions behind a Christmas tree, or what people leave out for Santa in Eastern Europe, then you're probably a lot like me. My name's Jeff, and I absolutely love Christmas. Join me on the Lost Christmas Podcast and learn about the people, traditions, mysteries, food, celebrations, and all manner of history around the holiday season we all love. At the end of each episode, I also read a little bit from The Lost Years of Santa Claus, a book which fills in the gaps that we have in the story of our beloved gift giver.
We now return to our program.
Jack Frost returns home way too early because he wants to ask Father Winter about becoming a human, and Father Winter is not happy about this.
Well, I mean, how many times do you fundamentally change everything about yourself so you can win the love of a girl that's never talked to you or met you before?
I can think of a few times, but we're not getting into that in this podcast. That's a different podcast.
I don't want to talk about high school, Jerry.
No, he calls it insubordination, but Jack alleges it's Father Winter's fault for sending him down to do his job
snap.
Among the humans who can't even see him.
That never works.
I don't know if I buy that.
never works, man.
But I also don't buy Father Winter's excuse that nobody down there really wants to know Jack Frost. What?
Apparently Elisa does. So
Elisa does.
Yeah. I mean, a moderate amount.
Yeah. Well, that's what Jack tells him. He says one person does. She called me a hero.
Well, and now we're back to Rise of the Guardians.
Yeah,
because
that's right.
Don't really believe in Jack.
Yes. So he humbly asks to please let him live among the humans.
Mm-hmm.
Father Winter tries to stall, so he says, give me time to think. Give me a century or two. But, of course, that'll be too late. Yeah. This guy's so disconnected with the world below, he doesn't even know how long humans live.
Right.
Here's where Jack finally gets to finish his song, then, explaining his wish.
I'd like to be like everyone I see, not special, just an ordinary guy.
But he finally relents. Well, if you're really that lonely, then he'll have to just grant his wish. And then he comes up with some weird stipulations.
Right. Necessities.
Necessities, yeah. He says. Yeah, he explains he can give Jack a winter's worth of humanity. And after that, if he wants to remain a human, he has to get four things before the first sign of spring. Calls them the basic human essentials. Write this down, everyone. You need a house, a horse, a bag of gold, and a wife.
And don't feed him after midnight.
And don't get him wet
after midnight.
Okay. So we need shelter, transportation, money, and love, and he can stay human. I understand a tiny bit, but what kind of messed up sea witch magic are we dealing with here?
The horse was the one that always gets me, because if he's just going to be a tailor in a town, does he really, really need a horse? I mean,
it's a status thing,
I guess.
Yeah.
You can't just be a human. You've got to be like at least middle class.
Oh, okay. Right? Yeah,
what tailor should we go to? Not that one. He doesn't even own a car.
He doesn't even have a horse, man. Come on.
That's right.
Yeah.
Poor humans don't count. You can't be a poor human.
That's right.
Everyone in the town is poor.
Yeah, man.
Well, then why do you want to hang out with them?
That's right.
Oh, no.
I think this and the money was just a discouraging, like just to discourage him from ever succeeding.
The impossible tasks.
Father Winter's like, there's no way. These people like use ice for money. How is this guy going to get a bag of actual gold?
Right. Yeah. I'm trying to help you here. No, you're not.
It's like the 12 labors of Hercules, except
that's right.
For Jack Frost.
Yeah.
the four items of Jack Frost.
But before Jack heads down to the surface, Snip gives him a pair of his snowflake snipping scissors to remember him by. Don't worry, he's got a drawer full of them. And then down he goes. But Father Winter decides to turn Jack into a human while he's falling to Earth.
I thought the same thing. What does Father Winter think humans can fly?
I don't know. I mean, they make it seem fun. Oh, I can feel my heartbeat. Oh, I have an itchy nose. I'm screaming at the TV. You're plummeting to your doom. Yeah, I'll make you human, but good luck surviving the fall.
Again, this goes back to gravity rules.
Yeah, if you want it enough, it's going to happen. You're going to make it happen. So.
Yeah.
No, it's weird.
It's okay. He lands on an extra springy tree branch, which doesn't immediately snap, but flings him safely onto his butt.
Or pummel his internal organs.
He
fell from the sky onto a tree.
He would have reached terminal velocity. So, I mean,
well, that's like also true. Yeah. Like he would have been dead for sure. But like when Sylvester Stallone in First Blood, like jumped off the cliff onto the tree, like he legit broke some ribs. So at the very least, you know, he's got some internal bleeding or something.
Listen, I'm still playing Tears of the Kingdom. I got a suit that lets me like negate any impact from my fall.
Okay.
So, I can dive on my head and be fine. I got a suit that can do that now.
He just needs a tanuki suit. You know?
Sure.
What if, hear me out. What if much like Men in Black, the spirit sprite thing of Jack Frost just slips inside like a human skin.
Mm-hmm.
So there's really nothing inside it, right? It's just skin. That's why you can flop around.
There it is.
Yeah.
See?
He's not officially human yet, so
that's the only solution.
It's just a weird costume.
That's right.
Yeah. And his first words to Elisa are,
I have words now. I think I almost spoke one. I have bones now. I think I almost broke one,
or all of them. But
super impressive. That's the way to impress a girl.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
They like poetry, but she notes Jack is very clumsy on ice, and he takes offense to this, gives her the old, do you know who I am? And she weirdly replies, well, you're certainly not my knight in golden armor.
Golden armor, not shining armor, but golden armor.
Yep.
She's just setting expectations. It's very nice to meet you, random dude who fell out of a tree and can't ice skate. Don't touch me.
Got to set those boundaries.
Right.
Yeah.
I think that's actually a safe boundary. I think that's good.
Yeah.
That's fair.
Yeah. And instead of telling her he's Jack Frost, which, she wouldn't believe he's the Jack Frost, especially since he can't walk on ice with his new clumsy human feet. It could still be his name, and she might take their meaning as some weird serendipity thing. But no, he pulls out Snip's scissors and introduces himself as Jack Snip, a tailor.
Jack Snip. I love it.
And Elisa excitedly tells him, oh, you're a tailor? We need one of those in town. And tells Jack he should come to January Junction with her. And off they go, Jack continuing to slip all over the ice.
Jack Snip is like the worst, the usual suspects ever.
Yeah.
You know, and he's just looking at the board and just picking names off everything, you know.
It's terrible.
It's
the Alamo.
That's right. Snip.
Jack yes, Snip. Jack yeah, Snip. It.
He's just trying to Kaiser Soze his way.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that's right.
Life.
And the real Snip and Holly are watching him from above, very worried about him. And here's where Father Winter tells them, we can't let Jack Frost get hurt. I'm sending you two down to watch over him so he doesn't die.
But he doesn't give them their powers, right? He doesn't keep them in their like spiritual or whatever sprite form.
No, he turns them into humans too. Again, mid-free fall. Stop doing that.
So now he's got like an older gentleman and a little girl that he's got to watch out for as well.
Yeah, and, but first, Elisa takes Jack Snip to her home, invites him to dinner, and asks her parents if he can stay the night in their attic. They agree, and Jack confidently tells them, oh, I'll find a horse the following day. It's very important that he finds a house, a horse, a bag of gold. Mm-hmm. But Elisa and her parents explain, there are no empty houses in January Junction, and Kupla Kraus owns all of the house building materials and the only horse in the kingdom and all the gold. This is where they call him the Cossack King, but even Cossacks don't want to live in his kingdom, so they left him alone in his castle, and here's where he sings a song all about himself.
I'm Kupla Kraus, I'm King of all the Cossacks. But there are no Cossacks to be king of. There's the rub, there's the rub, there's the rub.
There's the rub,
there's the rub.
That's great.
Apparently, this song used to get cut from TV, but after ABC Family became Freeform, they put it back in.
Huh.
And AMC kept it there. But this is probably the best song in the whole thing.
I agree. Yeah.
Yeah, probably.
It's the catchiest for sure.
Oh, yeah. It's about how he's not really the king of anyone. He's lonely. Jack's lonely. You'd think they'd come to a mutual understanding later. They don't.
This is like a really adult-themed kind of special here.
It is. You start to sympathize with the villain.
You know, like, it's not, I mean, I guess they all are on some level, but this one just feels a little bit more, maybe because there's not, like, a reindeer that's, you know, an anthropomorphic reindeer that's talking, or snowman that's alive. It's literally just people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so, I don't know, it just feels more adult and heavy than I think the others do.
Sure, yeah. You eventually sympathize a little bit with Zero and other villains, but this one, they, like, kind of pull at your heartstrings earlier than most of the others. Mm-hmm. But since no person or even animal wanted to live with Kubla Kraus, he made a bunch of iron robots to live with him instead.
Smart. Mm. Nice.
We've already seen his horse Clang Stumper. He's built a clockwork servant who looks like a little wind-up tin man. His name is Fetch Kvetch.
Fetch Kvetch, yeah. It's true.
He's got a little iron ventriloquist dummy named Dommy, whom he talks to when he needs to feel better about himself.
Dummy, dummy on my knee. Who is handsome as can be?
You are, Kubla.
And dummy, who is brave and strong and nice?
You are, Kubla.
Terrifying.
You're the best, Kubla.
That was really good.
Who you like better, him or me or Frost? Or what do you say,
you,
me or Frost?
Kubla.
You, Kubla.
God, you guys are so much better at that than I was.
He's made a whole army of robot Knights. They emphasize Knights. The K in Knights.
Mm-hmm. Knights.
And even a bunch of wind-up mice to live in a mouse hole in his castle. The man's got abandonment issues real bad.
He needs to just market these, you know, like, he didn't have to steal. He could literally just sell these and to different kingdoms, and he'd be rich already. You
sure,
know?
Yeah.
Like,
he clearly is not very self-reflective, because he knows enough to know he's lonely, but not enough to know he's a huge jerk who drove everybody away from him. So the reason he's lonely is himself.
Right. Mm. Yeah. Why is everybody leaving?
Insight is often missing from villains, I've noticed.
Mm. Yeah. Yeah. You know, the old trope of men will literally do anything instead of go to therapy. That's Kubla Kraus.
Let's just build some knights.
Yeah.
Knights.
All right. I got to build hundreds of these guys to keep me company. Not going to no doctor.
Who needs a doctor? He's got Dommy.
I'll build a doctor. Right. Come on in, Iron Doctor.
Just put a doctor's hat on Dommy, and suddenly you have, an in-home therapist.
He's got his own therapist, yeah.
Seem okay to me, Kubla. But back at Elise's place, Snip and Holly arrive at the door, and Jack introduces them as his old friends. They note how little Holly is, and Jack stumbles through an explanation that, oh boy, more gypsies.
Mm-hmm.
Holly angered the Gypsy King and he turned her tiny. Why?
Because it was the 70s, man.
I guess. This could have been a half hour special, but y'all had to make it silly. Then he can't call Snip Snip because he's Jack Snip. So the real Snip introduces himself as
Fernando Leonardi. Kratsky the Papalopoulos. That's me. What? It's all I could think of.
Fernando Leonardi Kratsky the Papalopoulos. Oh, my dude.
Why did it remind me of Sean Connery's character from Highlander? You know, Ramirez.
Yeah.
I don't even remember all. There's like a bunch of names.
Yep.
Chief Metallurgist to.
Yeah.
Right.
To Father Winter.
It's just like, hey, this is my friend Sam. Oh, cool. Come on in. Done.
Yeah. Yeah.
But having heard about how bad Kubla Kraus is, Jack's got his mind set on overthrowing Kubla Kraus. So first thing tomorrow, he says he and his friends are going to pay him a visit. And with a crack of lightning over the castle, we go to commercial.
I love the crack of lightning because it reminds me of Muppet Family Christmas as well. Take a look at this. When he opens the door. And you just hear the thunder. It's great. I just feel like I could see Snip, like, you know, just opening the door and Jack, whoa, the Kubla Kraus.
The Kubla Humunga.
If you ever sold merch, that would be a shirt I'd buy.
Yeah.
Just a door and Jack just Kubla Humunga.
That's way too much of an inside joke to put on a shirt.
A little bit, but funny.
Yeah, but I'd buy it.
Throw it on Redbubble. You can get a few orders. Those
sure.
Are
yeah. Yeah.
That's right. Yeah. That's right.
Well, we return after those messages, and pardon me, Pete continues his story, telling us Jack kept his word and heads straight for Kubla Kraus's castle the next morning. But the castle's on top of icy, miserable mountain that they can't even climb up. And Kubla Kraus and Dommy are just watching from the window and laughing. But Kubla's attention very quickly turns toward Elisa. And he gets to sing another song about how beautiful she is, and he will woo her and make her his wife.
Which he does, he tries in the creepiest way later on.
Well, and through the whole song, he makes Dommy crack back at him. How will you woo her? She doesn't like you.
She is beautiful, and therefore I will woo her.
How can you woo her? She doesn't like you.
She's a woman, and therefore I will win her.
How can you win her? She doesn't like you.
And now that I think about it, I just described every ventriloquist's act.
Yeah. You sure did.
Yeah, yeah.
It's not often that the villain gets two songs, though.
That's true.
That is true. Yeah.
Yeah.
But just when you thought they were being sympathetic toward him, Kubla Kraus's very next line is, "She's a woman, and therefore I will win her." And now I understand. He's an incel. That explains a lot, actually, but Jack eventually gives up trying to climb up the icy mountainside and sets up shop as a tailor right in Elise's parents' house. That's fine. He's not there during the day. He's working the pumpkin farm. But now we finally cut to Christmas Eve. There it is.
Hey, how about that?
Remember when this was a Christmas special?
Remember when he was supposed to be given a winter and winter doesn't start until the 21st of December? So I'm just wondering, like, why he was there so long.
Yeah, well, it's been 4 days.
Is it? Is that all?
Yeah.
Have we confirmed?
Yeah.
Confirmed? Okay.
But in walks a literal knight in golden armor. Elisa wasn't just daydreaming about her ideal man. This whole time she was talking about an actual person she knew.
Yep.
His name is Sir Ravenal Rightfellow. Even his name is Mr. Rightfellow.
Rightfellow, yeah.
Yeah.
That's right.
Well, Rankin Bass has never been very subtle.
No.
No.
No. That's true.
That's true.
After all these years, I'm home for the holidays, and I need a tailor.
Sir Ravenal is voiced by Sonny Melendrez. That's another returning voice from the stingiest man in town. He was Bob Cratchit.
Oh, nice. You know, I remember when I was in high school and we were reading like La Morte d'Arthur, and we were talking about Sir Galahad and Sir Lancelot and Sir Ravenal Rightfellow.
All those
classic King Arthur knights.
He got cut from Monty Python.
That's right.
Wasn't funny enough, but he's one of the knights of King Arthur, apparently, who's returned home for the holidays. But what I want to know is, where's King Arthur? Is this his kingdom Kubla Kraus has taken over?
Yeah, like, why aren't his knights doing anything about this tyrant, right?
Yeah, it's just like, nope, we're over crusading.
We got to find the Grail, guys. Like,
yeah,
good luck.
Yeah, that's right.
Good luck with all that.
Sure. Anyway, it turns out Sir Ravenal is here because he's in need of a tailor, probably because golden armor is a terrible idea.
Yes. So soft.
Yeah.
It's softer and heavier than iron. It'll just weigh you down and get you stabbed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it is heavier, so presumably he's jacked underneath, right?
Oh, yeah. His top half is just... He is jacked. Yeah. But no, his cape needs mending because, of course, the knight in golden armor has a cape. No capes.
What if it's just gold plated?
Maybe it's gilded.
That's right.
Yeah, I mean, if you're going to make an entrance, you need a cape.
That's right.
Yeah.
So Elisa tells Sir Ravenal she's certain Jack Snip would be honored to fix his cape. And Sir Ravenal says he'll call for the cape tomorrow. Smooth move, but wait, tomorrow's Christmas. Whatever. Pardon Me Pete now explains, since everyone in January Junction was so poor, they exchanged what they called dream presents, meaning they passed around an empty gift box and daydreamed about something they want.
Right.
It's just what I always wanted.
Yes.
Why don't they just leave?
I don't know.
Like, can it be worse elsewhere?
The Cossacks did.
Well, also, why would you set up a town next to something called Miserable Mountain? Like, it seems like you're just asking for it, you know?
When you see a wide shot later, it's actually kind of far away.
Oh, well, there you go.
Yeah, I'm also really confused about how, like, I get that he has these clockwork knights. Knights, excuse me.
Yes.
that's right.
It can't be that hard for a village full of people to defeat them. They're clock. They don't think they're clockwork.
You just push them over, right?
Push them over.
Yeah, he doesn't have like a mecha, right?
It's not. No.
It's not like freaking Voltron.
It hurts when they punch.
I mean, we don't know. We can't confirm that they don't, but it doesn't seem that they form a Voltron of sorts.
No, they never get that far.
Although a clockwork Voltron.
Man, there's like so many good shirt ideas for this.
Still working on that. Yeah, really. But
the Knights Voltron.
But this song, Just What I Always Wanted.
You shouldn't have, you didn't. Oh my, I really don't deserve it. I think I'll cry. It's just what I always wanted. It's perfectly right. It's just what I always wanted. A Christmas delight.
This is basically the dinner scene from the movie Hook. You're playing with us, Peter. Love that scene. But
yeah, it's great.
That's true. Mm.
I mean, how many times did you actually practice your rude, crude bag of pre-chewed food, dude?
Enough that I could do that. But Jack is on board with this game from the beginning. He's the one who starts singing. So it's a cute little scene, a cute little song to add to your Christmas playlist if you can find it. This makes up for the rest of the Christmas special's lack of Christmas.
Christmas special in quotes, you know.
Yeah, well.
Yeah. In name only.
Yeah. So they could fit it up with the group of everything else.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we need something for December. Here you go. But Sir Ravenol surprises Elisa with a real present. It's a rose. While y'all were singing about your wonderful imaginary gifts, this dude just went and found a flower.
In winter.
It's that easy.
He's smooth. He's a smoothie.
Yeah. And he asks her out to that evening's Christmas dance, and she accepts. But as she's walking home, she meets Dommy.
Hello.
Why, hello, little fellow.
And how is the New Year's bride?
I'm not a New Year's bride.
That's what you think.
But then out pops Kubla Kraus, who kidnaps her and rides off in a squeaky iron horse.
I love this. It's so ridiculous.
Yeah. It's amazing. It's genuinely incredible.
He just pops out.
Past her parents' pet duck. Remember they have a random duck?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's right.
Well, the duck is visiting family in the forest for Christmas while Kubla rides past them with Elisa. So the duck flies off to tell her family, and it's a good thing Jack Snip can speak duck.
Mm-hmm.
Mm.
So the whole family heads out to save her, led by Sir Ravenol, pulling the rest of them on a one-horse open dog sled. Jack again tries and fails to climb up the icy mountain, complains to the real Snip he can't do anything right as a human.
Right.
Meanwhile, Sir Ravenol ties a rope to an arrow, shoots a crossbow up the castle wall for him to climb up, and makes short work of Kubla's army of knights.
Yeah, he's like legit awesome.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, yeah.
He's got real skills that are amazing.
He's an actual hero. Yeah.
Yeah,
that's right. Poor Jack. Like, he just doesn't stand a chance.
Right.
You know?
No, yeah. Not at all.
They conveniently told us earlier that all of these knights were mechanical, so they could animate Sir Ravenol lobbing off their heads with his sword.
Right? Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. See, it's okay. There's a spring coming out of their neck. It's okay if they're not human. That's why the Foot Clan in the Ninja Turtles cartoon was made up of robots.
Same, yeah, right. Exactly.
But
oh man, can you imagine if he had just been like swinging that sword and you would just see blood squirting out of everywhere? Like that would have messed me up as a kid, I think. Or maybe not. I saw Commando and all those. Conan the Barbarian.
Right.
So maybe not.
Nothing I haven't seen.
But. Right.
Anyway, he carries Elisa to safety, but it turns out Sir Ravenol was wounded in the battle, so Mama and Papa help bring him to their house. Meanwhile, Jack, Snip, and Holly are on the other side of the mountain, still trying to climb up. They have no idea that Elisa has already been rescued, and they end up getting captured by the surviving knights.
Mm-hmm.
Mm.
They get thrown in the castle jail while Kubla sends an army of 1,000 knights to destroy January Junction.
This guy.
And as Jack watches helpless from his barred window, he tries to whistle up a snowstorm, forgetting that he doesn't have his magic anymore.
Hmm.
And he doesn't even hesitate to call out to Father Winter, immediately gives up his humanity to regain his powers and, quote, whistle up the worst winter the world has ever known.
Mm-hmm.
We call that a tantrum.
That's right.
I'm not getting what I want, so we're changing the rules.
Snowstorms are weather fits. The special goes to commercial here, but as it does, we get a really great shot of clouds rolling over the castle, but the clouds look like actual video of real clouds behind the model castle. It was a really well done effect.
It could have been.
I think it was.
Like you said, Jerry, it was late.
I like when animators do this. I'm going to do another special later this season that does this a lot, but that's for another day.
Oh, nice.
For now, Jack, Snip, and Holly return to the kingdom of the winter clouds to create, quote, the Christmas blizzard of all time. And with the help of Father Winter, they freeze the whole castle and bury the army of Knights in the snow. Pardon Me Pete tells us the blizzard lasts 5 whole weeks, which 5 weeks after Christmas is January 29th. But we jump a few extra days to the 1st of February, which, Jerry, by your reckoning, is still the Christmas season.
That's true. Yeah.
Candlemas.
Candlemas Eve, yeah.
It's not just Jerry. That's facts is what that is.
There it is.
This guy gets it.
February 2nd is 40 days after Christmas, and that is the Feast of Candlemas, celebrating the presentation of Jesus at the temple in Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm.
And when you throw out your tree.
And that's when you throw exactly. out your tree. We can't have a real tree in our house because my wife's allergic.
I am too. I have
We have a fake one as well. Yeah.
I like it when she breathes, but...
It's pretty nice
like
to breathe.
Too. Yeah,
I can lie. Yeah,
I prefer it.
Big fan.
Yeah,
I can't stand pain. It hurts me.
So. Anyway, Kubla's castle and only Kubla's castle is now entirely buried in snow. January Junction's fine. In fact, they're starting to talk about an early spring over there. At least Sir Ravenel is. He's still nursing. I don't know what, but his arm's in a sling.
It's probably sore from decapitating all those robots.
Yeah, man.
That's his injury.
Tennis elbow.
Yeah. I got sword elbow.
Yes. Yeah, my labrum is sore from being undefeated.
Yeah, man. I can't do the left-handed thing like Inigo Montoya.
Yeah, that's right.
He's the man in gold, not the man in black.
That's
anyway,
the man in black. Yeah.
He tells Elisa when the first blossom of spring arrives, they'll get married. And she's happy at first, but quickly adds with a twinge of sadness, she wishes Jack Snip could be there. Doesn't know why that's so important to her, admitting she only knew him for a few weeks.
Yeah.
Hey, guy, I only knew for a few weeks. Why are you not at my wedding?
Right.
He was her backup.
I was thinking maybe she needed him to like work on her dress.
Yeah,
there you go.
That's it. Yeah, look, I like need that. A dress.
Practical. Yeah, yeah.
It was. I'm purely selfish. She doesn't really need him. She needs a tailor.
That's yeah, that's it. So yeah, like, no. Yeah.
He doesn't even have a horse. Don't go to that tailor. Yeah.
No. Well, she doesn't know what happened to him. He just up and left.
Yeah,
but meanwhile, it appears Jack Frost has run out of winter, so he goes to Father Winter to ask what up with that, and Father Winter tells him it will indeed be an early spring and there's nothing he can do about it. He explains here he takes his orders from nature, and when she gives him a sign, he knows it's time to leave. And that sign is the dang groundhog.
Or, you know, Snow Miser's about to be born. I don't know. I'm just speculating.
But here comes Pardon Me Pete to sing us a song all about him.
Hey, I've got a day named after me, February 2. That's the day that I decide what the weather's gonna do.
Oh boy, now when you talk about memorable songs, I've had this one. I've got a day named after me.
February 2. It's a fun song.
You know, it is a fun song, yeah.
Want Buddy Hackett to sing you your song.
That's a really good Buddy Hackett.
That's a good Buddy Hackett.
And he also pronounces the R in February. We all know that February has that extra R in it. And nobody pronounces it. Nobody
My dad it, does.
So. Does he really? Oh, wow.
My dad always corrected us, February.
Because it just sounds so weird when he's singing it. I've got a day named after me, February 2.
That's so he can remember it's there. Maybe like Romeo Muller probably. Or someone was a real stickler about it too, like my dad always is. February. Maybe. Fine. But this song's fun. Bring that back on Groundhog Day. We need something else to listen to besides the Pennsylvania Polka and I've Got You, Babe.
Those are the only two I ever listened to.
Yeah.
I hear Happy Birthday because it's my mom's birthday.
Oh, nice.
Oh, there you go.
That every year.
There you go.
So that's the song we get to hear.
While Father Winter explained the whole thing with the groundhog and a shadow to Jack, who sees it's an overcast morning on the 2nd of February, so he decides to take it upon himself to scare Pardon Me Pete back into hiding by pretending to be Pete's shadow.
There's no groundhogs in England. Just going to poke that hole and leave it there.
Are we in fine. England? They don't say.
I don't know. It could be. I
King
mean,
Arthur?
We're somewhere in Europe. So, yeah, no, there are no groundhogs in Europe.
Well, yeah, but Cossacks are around, too.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, again, groundhogs are native to North America only. So, I mean, unless they crossed and then came back with the Vikings.
Too
I
early for that. Happened. It's King Arthur.
Well, the Vikings came in, I think, like 800 or something. So, yeah, you know, if we're mixing timelines, then, you know.
I guess it depends on which Arthur you think is a real King Arthur.
Yeah.
That's right.
They didn't do the research. Why should we? But
that's right.
Why let facts get in the way of a good story?
Yeah.
Let's just do this.
Fair.
So Jack's pretending to be Pete's shadow, but then he transforms from Pete's shadow to his own silhouette to a giant, dark, ghastly figure that chases Pete back into hiding.
Got to scare him back.
Yeah.
That's the Jack Frost I want.
Yeah, it is.
The ghastly one.
Yes. But Pete tells us he got to go back to bed for 6 more weeks, and he liked the extra sleep so much he's been letting Jack scare him to this very day.
Here's the other thing. Is this groundhog 1,000?
That was my, yeah. Like, how old is this groundhog for real? So maybe he's just like this magic creature as well. I have no idea.
Perhaps he has some sort of bargain with one of the like weather people.
Could be.
You know,
yeah.
Oh, maybe.
For
yeah.
this purpose.
Yeah. Well, if he's nature's sign, you know, if he's Mother Nature's sign, then maybe she bestowed upon him some sort of prolonged life. I don't know.
Maybe.
Because Pete's telling this story like it was him that first Groundhog
right.
Day.
Yeah.
It's not like the Santa Claus where it's like, it's passed down. It's the same guy, but. So Jack reports back to Father Winter that the groundhog saw a shadow and Father Winter buys it. Just, okay, I guess spring isn't coming.
Oh, my bad.
Have fun storming the castle. Literally, but.
I can't see it. I don't see what you just did.
Right.
Oh, all right.
He's not paying attention. He doesn't know how long humans live.
He also lets people plummet from, you know, the sky.
That's true. Yeah.
Survive, so.
Yeah. You can survive, right?
He has no concept of what happens to reality. Yeah.
No, I live on a cloud.
Like when you watch I Love Lucy and Ricky's just like reading the paper while all the shenanigans are happening. He's,
yeah.
You know, that's
oh,
like
yeah.
him. He's just, he's just there.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
But 6 weeks later, Father Winter declares it's finally time for spring to begin at noon that day. And here's where Jack begs him to make him human again. You promised me humanity until spring comes. You gave it up to save the town, my dude.
Yeah, yeah. No takebacks.
No.
Mm-hmm.
But Father Winter is a generous being, so he allows Jack to be human again until noon, which, by the way, is in an hour. It's already 11, and if Jack wants to stay human, he's got 1 hour to get himself that house, horse, golden wife. Remember all that stuff he was supposed to get and didn't?
Mm-hmm. Good luck.
Yeah, he was really busy during that 6 weeks.
Yeah.
He had some stuff to do, some laundry. And yeah.
He's doing this blizzard. Sorry. That's what he's doing.
I mean, that takes what, like a day and a half? We just got to get it started, right? Because
yeah.
He's not the North Wind. He's just like freezes.
That's true.
No, yeah.
Started,
we meet the North Wind and the Miser Brothers.
That's right. Uh-huh. But Jack's not even worried about that anymore. He's focused on stopping Kubla Kraus now. So Kubla Kraus is excited to see the snow finally starting to melt so he can escape the castle, storm the town, and take his bride. But wait! All that melting snow collapsed the roof of the castle, and a big old crossbeam lands right on top of Kubla. Like Batman Begins when they set Wayne Manor on fire.
Mm. I was thinking, you know, it's all location, location, location.
Yeah, well, that knocks out Kubla, and Jack enters the castle, and we just now learn that he can do impressions. because he does a pitch perfect impression of Dommy.
Of Dommy.
No time to use the secret passage. Down the mountainside.
You know, the one he couldn't climb up because it was too slippery. So all these robot Knights just fall down the mountain like a bunch of lemmings.
I mean, you know.
Yeah, that's what they're programmed to do.
That's right. They take orders.
That tracks.
I feel like he could have done that Dommy impression a little earlier to, I don't know, get the Knights to free him from jail.
Right? Yeah, but that would have been smarter.
Yeah.
I think there's any number of times when that would have been useful.
Sure.
Throughout the entire story would have been incredibly useful.
Yeah, but Kubla wakes up, charges at Jack Frost, and Jack just jumps out of the way, allowing Kubla to fall out the window behind him. And when he does, Father Winter blows a gust of wind, sending Kubla Kraus who knows where.
I don't know.
All the way to Sombertown.
That's right.
This is very Batman, you know. I'm not going to kill you, but I don't have to save you.
If he can control who doesn't fall to their death when he turns them human, he can probably control who does.
Well, he was really counting on Jack to be like, whoa, forget it. Just change me back, you know, mid-fall. Yeah.
But that means Kubla's castle is empty. So Jack decides, hey, this counts as a house.
Mm-hmm. Squatter's rights.
And hey, Kubla's iron horse is here. And oh, look, a giant pile of gold I didn't see before.
Finders keepers.
Yep.
Right.
All that's left is to go find a wife. Time to go find the only single lady I know.
All the single ladies.
Just the one. But oops, too late. True to their promise, Sir Ravenol and Elisa are getting married at noon. Even though Sir Ravenol is right next to his bride-to-be in her wedding dress, by the way. No amount of bad luck can pierce my golden armor, no matter how soft the gold is.
Now I'm starting to think of Mordred from Excalibur. You know, he's got that golden armor as well. So I don't know, maybe she's not marrying a good guy after all.
He's fine.
That's shades of gray, right?
There it is.
That's right.
What's beneath that gold? But Jack sadly says, I thought she loved me. And Papa tells him, I never heard her say she loved anyone before Sir Ravenol except Jack Frost, but he's just a dream. And that's all Jack needed to hear as the clock strikes noon. And with a tear in his eye, he fades back into Jack Frost right in front of Papa, who's like, where'd that guy go?
And this is where he becomes like disgruntled and evil for Frosty's Winter Wonderland, you know?
That's right.
Here's where the heel turns.
That's why he's so ill-tempered.
This is the prequel. Yep.
That's right.
Yep.
But Sir Ravenol and Elisa come out of their house together arm in arm, and we see Jack Frost fly over them, blowing onto Elisa's bouquet of roses, turning them white with frost.
Mm-hmm. What was that?
An old friend kissed the bride.
Bittersweet. Yeah.
And Jack flies back up to his home in the sky. Pardon me, Pete, wraps things up, goes back to bed, and that's it. Some people might think this ending's a downer. I like it.
I mean, it fits, right? It makes sense.
Yeah.
The story. So I can't really complain about it too much. But then if you think about, you know, Frosty's Winter Wonderland had already come out and Jack Frost was kind of evil. And then, you know, we see him turn at the end when they invite him to be the best man. And then he's happy again. And Rudolph and Frosty's Christmas in July. So, yeah. I mean, he has an arc and it works out well, but
it does.
Yeah, it is a little, it's definitely bittersweet.
It's bittersweet, but also, like, he'll be okay.
He'll be fine.
Yeah. That's right. Yeah. Oh, yeah. He's totally going to outlive her anyway, right?
So,
yeah.
I think immortality will be fine. I think he'll be all right.
This is also what I meant by the original story of The Little Mermaid did it better. In the original fairy tale, The Little Mermaid doesn't win the princess heart and ends up turning to seafoam.
Seafoam. Yeah.
Jack Frost, thankfully, just goes back to being Jack Frost.
That's right. He gets off easy.
He sure does. But any final thoughts, fellas?
Lots.
Go for it.
Lots and lots of thoughts.
Talk more about non-Euclidean geometry.
let's talk about Jack Frost, the character, right? So Jack Frost comes from like the personification of Old Man Winter.
Yeah,
right.
Like Dead Morose from the East, or Kalevala from like Finnish mythology.
Sure.
So he's basically his own dad. Kind of like in this story.
Right.
It's kind of weird. Like, I'm a bit confused.
My own grandma. Grandpa. Sorry, go on.
No. So I'm just, I wish that Rankin Bass would put out like this enormous encyclopedia of their,
right? Yes.
I would buy that in a heartbeat.
Like, like we need, and of course it's not going to happen because both Arthur Rankin and Jules Bass are passed, and Rick is more interested in just, you know, about what actually is
the history,
but like they need like a story Bible, you know, just like,
I agree.
Like one of those big Legend of Zelda canon, you know, what is canon? You know?
Yeah.
That's like
Hyrule Historia for Rankin.
That's right.
Bass.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
I don't know who owns any of these properties anymore, but what they need is everybody's favorite word, say it with me, reboot. They need somebody to come together.
I know.
Create like a new modern.
They're split up. It's like, I forget what year it is, but I think it's everything.
I think it's
74. Yeah. Like 74 is the year without a Santa Claus. So everything that and before is owned by one company, and everything after that, which begins with the story of the first Christmas doll, all of the obscure stuff is owned by a different company.
Oh, well, then Jack Frost still is in those earlier, more well-known things.
No, nope, this is 79. This is the latter half.
The other Jack Frost.
Oh, the other
Frost.
Jack Frost.
Yeah. And by the way, Jack Frost in general would just be a public domain character.
Oh, yeah.
Anyway,
yeah.
So they could put him back in regardless. Right.
That's how Rise of the Guardians exists.
Yeah, they have a version. We're back at Rise of the Guardians.
The circle is complete.
So they have a version of Jack Frost that they could still keep from Frosty's Winter Wonderland. So I don't know. We could see. We could make it all work.
Anthony and I, for years now, ever since we did that Tis the Podcast bonus episode, we've had like this big, long plan of how we want to remake it all, but no one's going to pony up the cash to do this.
No,
so
of course not.
it's all a pipe dream.
Yeah,
really.
Or just like write a book or something. I don't know.
Yeah, exactly.
That's what it would wind up being, is write like some fan fiction, self-published.
Exactly.
You'd end up running into stuff like Winterbolt is not a public domain character.
Sure isn't.
Right.
I understand why this special isn't as popular as the others. Again, not a lot of Christmas in this story, but it still counts. We watched it on New Year's Eve. You can, of course, watch it on Groundhog Day to extend your Christmas to Candlemas.
Yeah, that's what we do.
Yeah. But underrated little special.
I agree, too.
There's enough weirdness in it that's not like over the top weird. That it, you know, at least the story, while it's not great, it's still better than some of the other stories out there.
Oh, yeah.
From some of their stuff. Like, I would take this over Pinocchio's Christmas, like, any day.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, it's still pretty fun. I enjoy it.
Yeah, it's a good time. Check it out. Mm-hmm. But thank y'all for journeying through this long winter with me.
Of course.
No problem.
Thanks for having us. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Anytime. And if people want to pretend to be your shadow and scare you back to bed, where can they find you on the internet, Jeff?
You can find me on pretty much any podcast service you use. Lost Christmas Podcast. I do a lot of history, mysteries, dig into the traditions of Christmas quite a bit. Find me, and I hope you enjoy it. Also, listen to these guys. They're great.
Matt.
My podcast is North Pole Radio. It's mostly for Christmas performers, but if you're interested in anything related to peeking behind the curtain at Santa, Mrs. Claus, elves, that kind of thing. Plus, once in a while, I do a fun episode. Jerry's been on and Mike has been on talking about various Christmas and Halloween specials. So once in a while, I do something else. That's, you know, available all the places the podcasts are, including the one you're listening to right now. And if you want to find me on the internet these days, I'm mostly hanging out on Threads. So it's Ace of Knaves 87. And Knaves is spelled with a K. So technically it could be pronounced Ace of Knaves.
That's great.
And Jerry.
So you can find me at totallyradchristmas.com. Or of course, linktree.com/totallyradchristmas for all the socials. The usuals. So I don't want to list them all here, but yeah, same thing. Anywhere you find podcasts, you'll hear me. And usually anybody else's show, you'll probably hear me as well. So that's the running gag. So I think at this point I've been on like 42 different podcasts.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah. It's something like that. But anyway, totallyradchristmas.com. So
yeah, please check out all of those things. You can find those links in the show notes of this episode. And to find me on the internet, just go to adventcalendar.house and you can take it from there. We're going to have a fun Christmas in July this year. There's a lot of weird stuff coming on the way. So I'll talk to y'all in a couple of days. Until then, for Jeff, Matt, and Jerry, from my secret vault of snowflakes designated to only fall on Christmas, this is Mike Westfall saying, please watch out for the icy patch, especially if you've just become human and have never used your legs before. Good night, y'all. Next time on the Advent Calendar House...
Does Sherman have what it takes to be one of Santa's elves?
You see, I never do anything right.
Find out on Santa's Magic Toy Bag next.